live streaming of our morning services. You have to forgive me. Sometimes I get a loss for words. Thank you all for joining us here at Genesis Church. Going to start things off with, of course, we've got to bring our kids here at Children's Church. This is Katie and Ken, and last week's episode was about Pharaoh and Joseph, and look at these snazzy hats. And then we also have Mr. Logan here, who is here in church today, and that is a snazzy looking hat. It is really nice looking, and want to thank Lisa and Ms. Darlene for everything they do with her kids. They are up here, they collaborate, they're up here during the week. Darlene cleans the church to help keep it clean between services. So many other people, Mac, Suzanne, Greg Stanley is working our computer back here with his wife Jennifer, my sister-in-law, and just thanks to everybody that keeps us going, because what you see right here is a really small part of really what makes up a church. Without all kinds of good folks, there wouldn't be a church. And I can't forget Kim, who's always on the lookout for our bears, for our Operation Bear Hug. That's been about 5 years now. And we're just really, really glad to, really, really glad to have everyone we have. Now, y'all also, our offering for anyone here is in the back by Greg. We're not passing it out. We're trying to do all our social distancing, follow all our social distancing rules and everything. And then if anyone wants to give by mail, our P.O. Box is P.O. Box 130, Pontiapath, South Carolina, 29654. That's Genesis Church, P.O. Box 130, Pontiapath, South Carolina, 29654. And we also have a PayPal link on our website, mygenesischurch.net. And for everyone that is given, is really appreciated. There's a lot of things running the church, the insurance calls, and rent, and utilities, and we really appreciate it. And let's see now. Want to start off with our prayer list with a video. This seems like a just young man doing some bowling, but what's so special about this? This is Jackson Gannon. This is a young man that 3 years ago had a horrendous car crash. The doctor told his parents he wouldn't survive. And then when they said, well, he'll survive, but he'll never be able to walk. Then once he walked, they said he'll never be able to talk or eat or know even when he's hungry. This young man is a walking, breathing example of God's grace and glory and the power of prayer. And speaking of prayer, I'm going to turn to our prayer list. Has anybody got any updates about anyone that's already on the prayer list? And y'all, if there are any updates on the prayer list for folks that are listening, please just let us, please just put it in the comments or message me personally. Is there anyone we can add to the prayer list? And again, y'all, please just let me know, like message me or put it in the comments and we'll add folks to our prayer list. We're just a really, really big believer here. If we're, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, please pray for Ryan. He's having a hard time. His nerves are just shocked.
We sure will, Kim. Kim's husband, Ronnie, he served with distinction in the Marine Corps here in Vietnam. Anyone that's ever served in the military, especially served in combat, you can sympathize with what Ronnie's going through. Those memories never, ever go away. And we'll certainly lift him up, and you too, Kim and Lee, and Will and Grace too. Y'all, anyone else that we can add to the prayer list? Yes, sir.
Sam Jackson.
I think, man, when the lunch didn't hit, we'd be glad have a lot of folks on there, and they all need it. But, Miss Darlene, are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. Well, Logan, you're going to be a force of one. Be sure to squeeze the hand sanitizer on your way back. I know Miss Darlene's got a snazzy lesson for you. All right, y'all, we're going to see a video here. It's really relevant with what we're going through and what we're going to be talking about today.
These have been challenging times, but the body of Christ has proven itself resilient. We've gathered in different ways, in different places, yet stood steadfast as the church. We have found peace in God's promise to never leave us or forsake us. In our separation, we have remained united. In our struggle, we have lived out our faith. In the midst of the unknown, we have leaned on the strength of an all-knowing God. Throughout history, the church has thrived in adversity, and this moment is no different. The power of God is unstoppable, His love unending, His grace unrelenting, His glory undeniable. Today, no matter where we gather, we remain God's people. Our mission has not changed. Our calling has not been altered. And nothing, absolutely nothing, will ever change that. We are the church, and today we stand resilient.
Joseph was in jail for a crime he didn't commit in a foreign land. And maybe we haven't been in a foreign jail for a crime we didn't commit, but I think most of us have been in a first-class mess at some point in our lives. There's a lot of things we can learn from Joseph's story. I'm going to start off in Genesis 39, verses 21 through 23. And Egyptians wrote a lot about their everyday lives. They're really unique. A lot of times archaeologists have to search in a culture to find out things. Egyptians took notes on almost everything, and they actually found some papyrus scrolls about prison conditions during the time that Joseph would have been in prison there. And it varies from, the prison could vary from an unused well all the way up to a work camp. And it looks like Joseph was in one of these work camps. He had, and these prisoners, there wasn't a justice system. The prisoners were there until Pharaoh decided what to do with them. Could restore them to where they were at, let them go. Could mutilate them, depending on their crime, or execute them. They never knew, it may take years. Joseph, though, he continued to have this trend. God blessed Joseph in that pit that his brothers threw him in. He wasn't killed. He blessed him when he was in slavery by Potiphar, giving him more and more responsibility and more freedom. In these verses, we can tell he's being blessed again. They found favor with the jailer, and the jailer put him in charge of what he had to do. None of these terrible circumstances changed what God had planned for Joseph. And just like with Potiphar, Joseph rose to the top of the prison system and really became the chief administrator. It'd be real easy to be mad at God for these circumstances. It can be hard to see God moving our lives when we're so far down our pit. A lot of us have been in situations where we don't know why we're there. We may not have done anything to get us there, and we don't see God moving. about to see God's hands in Joseph's life again. The next chapter, evidently the cupbearer, modern day butler, or the Pharaoh and the baker had got their boss real mad. And Pharaoh threw them in jail. They were in there with Joseph, and Joseph was in charge of them. And then one morning, Joseph noticed that they were really distraught. He asked them, "Why are you so sad?" And they told him, "We had a dream, and there's nobody to tell us what it is." And Joseph tells them, "All dreams and interpretations come from God, so tell it to me." Many of us have heard this story in Sunday school. Matter of fact, I think Ms. Lisa or Ms. Darlene Warren covered it a couple weeks ago. Joseph goes on to interpret the dreams of both these men. He tells the cupbearer, "In 3 days, you're going to be released, and you're going to go back to your old way of life." He tells the butler, the baker, in his dream, "In 3 days, you're going to be hung and killed by Pharaoh." And what Joseph tells him, it comes to pass, just like he said it would. In 3 days, 3 days later, the cupbearer, butler, was returned, he was forgiven, and returned back to his old spot. The baker was hung, and the birds pecked away the flesh on his body. I've heard this story so many times, from a child all the way up. There are a couple things here that I hadn't noticed before. Joseph was in prison, one of the worst prisons on earth at the time, and he cared enough about other people to ask them how they were doing. You're in an Egyptian prison, you've got sand everywhere, you know you're going to go out for a hard day's work. Who would really honestly care about how the other person's doing? He showed compassion for others, even in his misery. How many of us knows the misery of other people when we're having a hard time? I know our dishwasher messed up a few days ago, and if something had happened during that time to someone else, I can't say it would be at the top of my list to check on. But Joseph checked in with these people. I never really noticed that. Joseph did not know when he might be executed. There was no trial. You literally were, they would come in, drag you out, execute you, or mutilate you, or free you. Another thing I noticed was that Joseph gave God the glory for his ability. Spiritual gifts didn't start in the New Testament. Many of the Old Testament figures were gifted by God through the Holy Spirit. God blessed Joseph with the gifts of dream interpretation, having visions, and being a wonderful administrator. Throughout Joseph's story, though, he always gave God the glory. Always. And through this act of going beyond his own problems to help others, Joseph's life was about to take another turn. The cupbearer would end up forgetting about Joseph until 2 years later. His boss, the Pharaoh, was having a series of dreams. And the Egyptians, the Pharaohs, had access to probably the best advisors in the known world at the time. None could interpret what was happening. But Pharaoh knew it was significant. He kept having these same dreams over and over. His cupbearer remembered Joseph and told Pharaoh about him. Pharaoh sent for Joseph, and this young man who'd been in a hell of a prison for several years, in an instant, was clean shaven, washed, new clothes, and standing in front of the most powerful man in the world. Joseph interpreted the dreams of Pharaoh and gave credit to God. What the dreams meant were that there would be 7 years of plentiful harvest, just overflowing, and that would be followed by 7 years of famine. That would be unlike anything seen before. With the interpretation, God told Joseph to tell Pharaoh that Egypt would be okay if they took 1/5 of the grains harvest they had every year to take it back and store it up for the rough times. I've heard that before, but I got to thinking about it. This was a Jewish slave, a Hebrew slave in a foreign land, telling the most powerful man in Egypt, who was considered a god. Egyptians considered the Pharaoh the reincarnation of the living God. And he's sitting there telling him, well, God says you need to do this. That's encouraged. People being killed for less. As faith and obedience in its purest form. And Joseph exhibited that all through his life. And Pharaoh listens to Joseph. He does more than listen. He appoints Joseph to be the person to make all these arrangements for the storage of grain in Egypt. And more than that, he makes Joseph basically the prime minister of Egypt, second only to Pharaoh. All these years, taking care of his father's assets, and he was enslaved, taking care of Potiphar's house and his staff and his belongings. Then, when he was in prison, being basically the administrator of the prison, God had been working through these terrible situations to prepare Joseph for his final appointment. Throughout his life, he had been prepared for this moment. With all his struggles, God was bringing him to this point, this time, this place. God still does that for people. We don't recognize the misery that we're being groomed and grown. And if you really answer this honestly, when do we grow the most and learn the most? Is it when everything's going good or when nothing's going right? For my own life, I was 18. I didn't really have steady work. And a good friend of mine, Ms. Faye Holly, she's passed away now. She worked at the hospital in the Human Resources Department. And she got me a job as a janitor. And I thought that it was a job just to help get me through. Scrubbing toilets, scrubbing floors, doing a lot of stuff that wasn't real nice. I thought I was in my own pit then. I didn't realize God was working me towards something. He opened my eyes inside that hospital and showed me the path I was supposed to take. And what I thought was a hard time was actually being groomed to talk to people. If you can talk to people and recognize people as a janitor, janitors are basically invisible. This highlight, this spotlight they've gotten now in the coronavirus epidemic has been the first real mention of them in years. But being in environmental services, it gives you an idea, a way to look at people and see how they really are and communicate with them and the appreciation of hard work. That job led to a 30-year career and still going in healthcare. God, in our struggles, sometimes He brings us for something different. Maybe you're going through a really rough time right now, and you don't understand what good can come out of it. Remember Joseph's story. His story didn't end in the pit. It didn't end in the prison. It doesn't even end right now. There's still unfinished business. Later on in the book of Genesis, chapter 45, everything happened just like Joseph said it would. There were 7 years of a wonderful harvest, and Joseph looked over and organized the Egyptian storage of their food. They were the only country in the Near East that had any food at this time, including Canaan, where his brothers and his father was at. And Jacob had told his sons, go to Egypt. There's food there. And so they carried money, they carried silver. And they came before Joseph, the brothers who had thrown him in the pit, the brothers who had aimed to kill him. Joseph found out that he had another full brother. His name was Benjamin. Full brother, same mama, same dad. And he put his brothers through some tests. And they finally brought Benjamin back to be with him. In chapter 45, he couldn't stand it any longer. Joseph told him, I'm Joseph. Is my father still alive? Now, his brothers, it dawned on them, last time we saw this guy, we had sold him into slavery, and now this is the second highest man in Egypt. He might be a little ticked. And how many of us could honestly say that we wouldn't have been angry? Really, honestly, how many of us could say that? And they backed up. I don't know where they thought where they were going to run to, because that place was surrounded by Egyptian soldiers. But they backed up. They were stunned. He could have had them executed on the spot. That's the kind of power he had. What did he do? This second most powerful man in Egypt that controlled their lives with his hand for gain. Another point in Joseph's life. He made it to the palace. And he had the heart to forgive those who had threw him in the pit to begin with. Do you think he forgave them just because of them? Or do you think he forgave them for part of his own health? And it was the right thing to do. But many times, we hang on to grudges, and we hang on to these betrayals, this what's happened to us in our lives. And over time, the person that we're mad at, they move on, but we don't. Who are we really hurting? Hardest thing in the world can be to let go. But sometimes it's the most healing thing we can do, to let go. Joseph let go in that palace room to the brothers that threw him in a pit and started all this. Joseph recognized that God had used what they did to him, and he came full circle. By them throwing him in that pit and starting this odyssey of his life, he was able to save him, all of them, and his father from starving to death. Without that food in Egypt, they would have starved. This was a 7-year famine. There would be no harvest for another several years. God used their evil to make some good out of it. He forgave them and told them not to be upset with themselves for what they'd done. Pharaoh, out of his love and appreciation for Joseph, told Joseph, go get your dad, get all your family, bring them here to Egypt. I'll give you land in a place called Goshen. And Goshen, you may have heard it from the Ten Commandments movie. You may have heard it from, there are a couple songs by it, hymns. It was a very fertile part of Egypt. They would bring Jacob to Egypt where he'd be reunited with his long-lost son. And there's still another chapter in Joseph's life that we can learn from. At the end of Genesis, after Joseph's father Jacob had died, they carried him back to Canaan. He didn't want to be buried in Egypt, to a place that he had already pre-selected to be buried in. Joseph and all his brothers, along with Pharaoh's servants they sent with them to protect Joseph, they all carried Jacob's body back to be buried. And his brothers began to think daddy was probably the only thing stopping Joseph from throwing us in the pit or killing us. So they sent him a message saying that Jacob wouldn't want Joseph to hurt his brothers. And Joseph told him, don't be afraid. And then one of the Bible verse that I really come to use a lot, Genesis 50:20. As far as you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about the present result, preserve many people alive. I know people that they sought out to hurt people for their own evil intentions, but God used that and used it to make a new life for people. What you use for evil, God meant for good. And Joseph loved his brothers. He fully forgave them. And Joseph, years later on his deathbed, Joseph lived to be 110 years old. On his deathbed, he reminded his brothers of their acts of evil and how God used them for good. They lived in peace with each other. Joseph went on to tell his brothers, one day, you'll leave this land. Because God had already given his promise to Abraham, then to Isaac, then to Jacob. You are my people and I have land. The Pharaohs that would come later after Joseph died didn't know or didn't care about the relationship Joseph, what Joseph had done for Egypt. And they saw the descendants of the sons of Jacob growing and multiplying, and they sought to stop that. It took 400 years for the sons of Jacob and their families to leave. But they would leave. They would claim that land that was promised to them by God. Joseph's bones would go with them and end up being buried in Canaan, the land that they were promised. God worked in the life of Joseph. Joseph had many storms and many trials in his life. He never saw the lost side of God in all these storms. God uses the fires that we go through to refine us. And he used them to refine and strengthen Joseph into just the right person that God needed at that point, at that time. I used to think when I was younger, it was really sad how Joseph led his family here to Egypt, and then the Egyptians forgot about it, what he had done, and they were led into slavery. And I think that Joseph brought the family into Egypt, just the family. But through his work, they settled in a place that was so fertile that they grew and they ended up becoming a nation. Fulfilling Abraham, God's promise to Abraham, your descendants will be more than the sand, than the grains of sand on the beach. That was another part of Joseph's legacy. Sometimes we don't see the full stretch of God's hand and how the things that we do in our lives can affect others for years and years to come. That transformation from this family to a nation that still exists started with a 17-year-old kid that obeyed God and listened to him. He suffered assaults from his own brother. He was sold into slavery, put in prison with false accusations. There may be people right now who are listening to this or will be listening to it. Maybe you're trapped in a pit. Maybe you're trapped in a prison of addiction. Maybe you're trapped in a prison of unforgiveness. You won't forgive. give others, or worse yet, you won't give yourself. Those walls can be just as real as the prison that Joseph was in. Maybe you hear a knocking right now at these prison walls. That knock is Jesus. He's wanting you to shed these chains. These chains of addiction, these chains of unforgiveness. He's wanting to take you from this pit. Many times we live in the pit because we're too afraid to come out of it. Look at the example of Joseph. This man has storms in his life, had struggles. He never gave up on God. God never gave up on him. And through his struggles, God made some good out of it. A lot of good. You may think that one person can't make a difference. If one person could make, if one person could just help one more person find Jesus. If one person could just get their own life, talk to God and break these chains, it would be worth it because you saved your own soul. How many people in this country have slid away from Jesus? How many people in this country, the odds and the statistics for addiction dwarf anything this COVID virus is doing? People are dying every day. Heroin, prescription pills, cocaine, meth, alcohol. Families are being broken up. People are living in their own pits of misery. Joseph stayed obedient to God. God got him from the pits, got him through the prisons, and got him to the palace. And he wants to do the same with all of us. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer today. Father, we come to you in prayer as a shaking nation. We have been shaken to our core. Father, many of us feel like we are in a pit or a prison. We're uncertain about what's going to happen tomorrow. Father, many of us are struggling with addiction, we're struggling with physical illness, we're struggling with emotional illness. Father, we're struggling with unforgiveness, whether it's not forgiving another person or not forgiving ourselves. Father, all these are keeping us in the pits and the prisons and keeping us from being where we need to be at. Father, maybe you're working while we are in these struggles. And we're turning every direction except towards you. Father, give us obedient hearts. Give us ears for hearing and eyes for seeing. Give us minds for learning your word and your laws. And help us. Each individual. Father, if we have a similar goal, each individual, and we unite as one, Father, this country can turn around. This people can turn around. One person at a time, one family at a time, one church at a time, one town at a time. Father, help us to carry your words out beyond these walls. Help us to be more than 1 hour a week Christians. Help us to be your people, people that are pleasing, does right and do right in your eyes. Father, cares from the pits of addiction, cares from the pits of this unforgiveness, cares from the pits of looking at the world instead of looking at you. Bring us where we need. Father, let's look at Joseph's example. Through all the struggles he went through, he never lost sight of you. And Lord, help us to remember what he did, what you did through Joseph's struggles, and how many people it helped. And all these things, Father,